Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Invasive Mussel Collaborative webinar, Case Studies in Integrated Pest Management. This is Erica Jensen with the Great Lakes Commission, and on behalf of the Invasive Mussel Collaborative, we want to thank you for participating in today's webinar. The Invasive Mussel Collaborative is identifying opportunities to advance scientifically sound technology for management and control of invasive dry-seeded mussels in order to produce measurable ecological and economic benefits. The collaborative provides a framework for communication and coordination and is working to identify the needs and objectives of resource managers to prioritize the supporting science and align science and management goals into a common agenda. If you would like to know more about the Invasive Mussel Collaborative, we encourage you to visit our website at www.invasivemusselcollaborative.net. The website is intended to serve as a central hub of information on dry-seeded mussels. It also includes background information on the collaborative and recordings of past webinars. If you know of information or have resources that you would like to see incorporated into the website, please contact us. We also encourage you to join our listserv to receive webinar announcements, read about recent dry-seeded related news, and connect with other researchers and managers. A link to join the listserv is provided on our website. Today's webinar is part of an ongoing series of webinars hosted by the collaborative. The purpose of these webinars is to facilitate learning and information sharing on topics of common interest. It will be recorded and archived with past and future webinars on our website. Today, we are pleased to have representatives from the Great Lakes Fishery Commission, the City of Milwaukee Forest Operations, and the University of Michigan to share their experiences with developing integrated pest management programs and strategies, including methods and results, and to answer questions about their efforts. Before we begin the presentations, I have a few logistical items to cover. We are pleased to have a large number of people registered and attending this webinar. Due to the large number of people participating, all attendees' lines are on mute. Attendees will remain muted throughout the webinar, and we will only be taking written questions. Thus, if you have a question, you may type it into the questions pane of your GoToWebinar dashboard. Questions may be submitted at any time during the webinar. Depending on time, we may answer one or two questions following each presentation, but the majority of questions will be addressed after all three presentations have been given. Our first presenter today may need to leave the webinar early, so we will take a little bit of extra time after the first presentation to field questions for that presenter. So if you have questions for our first presenter, I encourage you to please submit them early so that we may address them. We will do our best to take all questions or comments during the webinar. If you have to leave the webinar before we have gotten to your question, we encourage you to review the recording that will be posted on our website to hear the answer at a later time. If you are experiencing technical difficulties, you may send a chat directly to one of our webinar organizers in GoToWebinar, Sarah Cook, and she may be able to help you resolve your technical challenges. Our first presenter this morning is Jill Wingfield. Jill is the Communications Program Manager for the Great Lakes Fishery Commission. She received a joint master's degree from the School of Criminal Justice and the Department of Fisheries and Wildlife at Michigan State University. She has been with the Fishery Commission, holding various titles since 2000. Today, her work focuses primarily on the development of communication and outreach materials, as well as regulatory and policy analysis in support of commission programs. Today, Jill will present on their sea lamprey control program. So, Jill, with that, we will make you a presenter. Then you can get started.
Excellent. Thank you. Hey, can everyone hear me good? Or hopefully. Thank you, Erica, for that introduction. As Erica said, my name is Jill Wingfield. I'm the Communications Program Manager with the Commission. And today I'm going to talk a little bit about how we have incorporated the elements of integrated pest management into the sea lamprey control program. So first I'll start off a brief overview of invasive species in the Great Lakes. We have more than 180 non-native species that exist in the lake. About 20 or so of them are a serious nuisance, either causing significant environmental damage or economic damage. And of those, only two of them can be controlled. Alewife are controlled through the stocking of Pacific salmonids, which began in 1966. And the control of sea lamprey, which is what I'll be talking about today, is conducted or facilitated by the Great Lakes Fishery Commission. Sea lamprey invaded through Lake Erie in 1921 and spread throughout all of the upper lakes by the mid-1920s. Invasive species really threaten are one of the leading threats to the $7 billion fishery in the Great Lakes. They are a nuisance, they compete with native species, they contribute to an unhealthy environment, they often bring with them disease and parasites, and they have a direct loss on the contribution of lost fish. Here in this image, you can see an open wound on a lake whitefish caused by a sea lamprey. Gets me right into the heart of our presentation here. Sea lamprey are the most destructive invader in the Great Lakes. Only one of seven fish that are attacked by a sea lamprey will survive, either dying directly from predation, as you saw in the photo on the previous slide, or from a secondary infection at the open wound site. This graph shows the impact that sea lamprey had on the commercial harvest of lake trout. So these orange lines show when sea lamprey were first observed in some of the upper lakes, and the impact on the lake trout population was immediate and brutal. This top predator and prized native species was decimated. A similar story can be told about other key species in the basin. Fortunately for us, sea lamprey can be controlled. And the control program is quite successful. The program has led to a 90% reduction in their population and is considered the most successful aquatic vertebrate invasive program in the world. The commission carries out its program by relying on a number of partners to implement various methods of control. The major components of the sea lamprey control program are lampricides, barriers, and traps. And I'll talk about each of these in a bit more detail. Since about the mid-1980s, the sea lamprey control program has incorporated elements of integrated pest management into the program. And I'll start with providing a little history of the way that IPM has sort of evolved through the sea lamprey control program. Starting in 1979, the commission hosted the first sea lamprey integrated symposium. And in a paper published by our former executive secretary, he stated that the most significant development that emerged from the first symposium was the policy of INSL, or Integrated Management of Sea Lamprey, which was really organized around the concept of integrated pest management. So the Integrated Management of Sea Lamprey, which we call INSL here, was developed as a principle in the early 1980s. The main integrated pest management concepts that were incorporated into our INSL program included defined targets for control, the application of alternative control methods, and the use of quantitative methods and systems approaches. When the commission developed its strategic vision for the 1990s, the INSL program was formally written into the vision and consensus about the future direction of how we would incorporate this into the sea lamprey control program was achieved. The program was again reiterated in the next vision, the vision published in 2000, directing the work of the commission from 2000 to 2010. And the vision statement for both of these documents directly connected the implementation of our sea lamprey control program to the achievement of our fish community objectives, which are set by fishery managers. So this was a big change in the direction for our program, where we started to evaluate the success of the sea lamprey control against fishery management objectives. Then starting in the mid-2000s, slowly started to evolve away from the integrated management of sea lamprey control program to the program we employ today, which is the integrated control of sea lamprey. The integrated control of sea lamprey still relies on a number of traditional concepts of integrated pest management. But one of the major deviations from that more traditional approach to IPMs is that our program now incorporates expert judgment into our decisions. And I'll provide some examples of what that means. But essentially, we moved from a program where we were relying solely on empirical data to drive our decision making to one where we had the opportunity to incorporate more of the collective knowledge from the sea lamprey control agents that were out in the field and had served on the program for many years. So the integrated control of sea lamprey program really highlights broad principles that can and should be applied to invasive species management universally. Those principles are prevention, monitoring, response, and evaluation. Tie very closely to some of the concepts of integrated pest management. So let me start first with prevention. The main objectives of prevention is to stop the introduction of a species and also to anticipate the next threat. However, in the case of sea lamprey, we essentially failed with prevention. When we realized that, by the time we realized that sea lamprey were a problem, they were already spread throughout all of the Great Rivers. That led to the formation of the commission, which was established in 1955, and the development of the Sea Lamprey Control Program. So from there, we moved to monitoring. The key objectives of monitoring are to identify early where a new introduction has occurred, and also to identify areas where an existing invader may be spreading its disease. In the case of the sea lamprey control program, monitoring informs us on the most effective method of control, and it also provides information to help us allocate our resources in the most efficient and effective manner. I'll provide a couple of examples of how that plays out in the program here. Regular monitoring of the system is essential to determine where we should be. Today, the way that we decide which streams are treated versus the way that we used to decide the way that streams were treated under the ENSL program illustrates how we've shifted from that very traditional integrated pest management approach to the integrated sea lamprey control program that we use today. So here's the first map here shows that I'll layer this map in and show how the streams are chosen based on the approach that we use in the program. First, we have here streams that are chosen based on known information about rates of sea lamprey reinfestation and larval sea lamprey growth, which really incorporates that expert judgment into our choosing. Next, we add in some streams that are chosen based on geographic efficiency. Meaning our crews are there, we know that these streams should be treated, so we end up treating them. And then next we have streams that we add in based on the effectiveness of a particular treatment, or on what we call a cost per lamprey killed basis. And that's where we bring in that more traditional empirical driven decision making known IPM. And then lastly, we add in a few more streams and larger river systems that are scheduled for cyclical treatment because they're known to be consistent sea lamprey producers, or because the complexity of the system makes treatment really difficult, and so the efficacy of the treatment is not as high as we're used to. Again, bringing in that expert judgment, expert knowledge about the system and the program. And then with the barrier component of our program, we have monitoring on many aspects of the program. We monitor upstream barriers to make sure lamprey aren't passing. We make sure that the status of barriers is maintained, meaning that they don't, often they need maintenance or we need to do some updating. And then a relatively new monitoring component of the barrier program is that the commission is assessing the necessity of barriers. Overall in the basin and throughout the country, we've seen this move towards improving aquatic connectivity. But the commission realizes sometimes barriers are necessary. So one of the ways that we try to facilitate this process is the development of a barrier mapping tool. This was developed in partnership with the Great Lakes Commission, and it helps users determine what would happen, what would be the result if a barrier was added or removed. For example, it'll show the number of impacted stream miles if a barrier is removed, showing how many, potentially how many more stream miles the Sea Lamprey Control Program would have to treat. The tool is linked to our Sea Lamprey Control Program databases, so there's the history of the control, lamprecide control in that area, provides information about larval population numbers, and some other really great information. And then we move on to response. This is where the Sea Lamprey Control Program and the Great Lakes Fishery Commission really expends most of its resources. The key objective of response is to move quickly, use as many resources, including technology and partners, as possible, and continue your response for as long as necessary. In the case of Sea Lamprey, this will be an ongoing effort because eradication is not possible. Our response is also determined by our budget, which is set annually. So the first rule, I would say, in determining whether or not your response will be effective is knowing your enemy, which translates to research. So here I would talk about, this is the life cycle of a sea lamprey, which was identified early on in the program and was really the catalyst to helping us develop a control program. Very similar to salmon, sea lamprey spawn in the stream. And so during their larval stage and then again as spawning adults, when they're in the stream rather than the open lakes is where we can target our control. We use the lamprecide target the larvae in the streams and typically barriers to prevent spawning adults from moving upstream. Also early on in the program, a survey of all of the Great Lakes tributaries was conducted to find out where sea lamprey were. We continue those surveys today to make sure that we're staying on top of the population, you know, where they're moving, and recognizing that as habitat is cleaned up and water quality is improved, sea lamprey like it just as much as fish, and so that this helps us continue to make sure we are in front of the lamprey as they move through the system. As I mentioned earlier here, we have an integrated approach to our sea lamprey control method. We rely on a number of partners and we employ several methods. So when I talk about response here, I'm really going to focus in on lamprecides and barriers. Application standpoint, as I talked about earlier when I was talking about monitoring, the control program selects streams for treatment each year based on a number of factors. So the 500 Great Lakes tributaries where sea lamprey larvae are found, 337 of those have been treated at least once, 184 of them require regular treatment, and most of those are treated on a 3 to 5 year cycle, which coincides with the minimum amount of time that larvae spend in the stream before migrating to the lake. This map shows just 1 year of a lamprecide application. This was 2015, to show the extent of streams that are treated with lamprecide. Barriers are used to prevent adult sea lamprey from migrating upstream to reach running ground. They were the first means of attempted control, actually predating the formation of the commission. The network of barriers that exist today consists of about 50 purpose-built barriers constructed by the commission and their partners, and numerous other dams that block migrating sea lamprey. We also make sure that all newly constructed barriers include traps to remove adult sea lamprey. And this is a focus of some of our efforts going forward is that we're looking to now expand that to not just including traps, but to developing fish passage technology to still continue to prevent sea lamprey from moving upstream, but allow desirable fish species to move upstream easily. Then we have a number of possible future control methods. I use two old adages when I talk about our philosophy for the future. The first one is don't let your foot off the gas. We've learned through the sea lamprey control program that as soon as we let up on control, the populations will come back and they come back with a bang. So we have to maintain a consistent and strong response on our control program. The other adage I like to say is don't put all of your eggs in one basket. We know that lampricide has been a very effective means of controlling sea lamprey. Barriers have been really great at stopping them, but we continue to push for future control methods, and all of that is possible through this commitment to research. This slide is a little bit busy, but I threw it in. This is one that was constructed by the folks that are working on our fish passage and aquatic connectivity efforts here in the office. And basically, what the take-home message I want you to get from this is that we're using various characteristics of a fish or of an invasive species, to attack them or develop control mechanisms. So here we're looking at life history, morphology, and behavior, and developing potential control methods, targeting or exploiting those different elements of the species. And then you can see up top here where we're exploiting those elements of a particular invasive species, we're still trying to promote the movement of fish through a water system. All right, and then lastly, let's talk briefly about evaluation. One of the concepts of traditional integrated pest management and the integrated control of sea lamprey is to define our targets for control, which can only be done through consistent evaluation of the program. We evaluate each individual lampricide treatment immediately following the treatment, and then again, further out, typically later in the year or the following season, so that we get a better estimate of the number of larval lamprey that have survived the treatment. We also evaluate our barriers on a regular basis. And I put this slide in just to show the potential impact of what happens if a barrier fails. So this is the Manistique River. And in the early 2000s, the barrier failed. It opened up 326 miles of lamprey spawning habitat, which now requires us to spend 550 staff days and $775,000 to treat every 2 years. For a while thereafter the barrier failed, we were treating it every year. The efforts to reconstruct the barrier have been underway for the past 12 years and counting, as they've been hung up with some permitting issues here in the state of Michigan. And this has had a rippling effect throughout the rest of the program. These are a lot of resources that we have to dedicate to one particular treatment area, which means that we can't spend those resources on other parts of the basin. And then, of course, we look at the overall impact of the sea lamprey control program. Since the inception in the mid-1950s, when communities were in decay, the fishery was in an utter state of devastation, the commission, with its partners, has had remarkable success. Today, sea lamprey populations have been reduced by 90%, as I said earlier, which allows fish stocks and the fishery and the economy to make an extraordinary comeback. So with that, I'll finish up here, and I hope I left some time for questions.
Yeah, thanks, Jill. And we do have a couple of questions. So the first one I'll ask is, what are the effects of lampricide to non-target species, and how do you deal with those effects, if any?
So lampricide, when the primary lampricide, which is TFM, was first discovered, it was the result of testing more than 6,000 different chemicals up at our research station, the Hammond Bay Biological Station, in partnership with the U.S. Geological Survey. And the remarkable thing about TFM is that it really is species-specific to sea lamprey. It basically impacts the sea lamprey don't have the enzyme needed to break down the chemical, whereas other fish species do, and so it builds up to toxic levels. We do have some non-target concerns, particularly with species like lake sturgeon, mud puppy, I think stone cat. So typically the way we try and address that is we look at the other characteristics of the system that we're treating. So if there's a, for example, if a particular species is spawning at that time or we know that there will be juveniles, we try and tailor our treatment time to avoid that window. We've also, we make sure we monitor a number of characteristics of the stream, which really plays an impact into how the lamprey side affects not just the sea lamprey, but potentially other species. So there we monitor things like the flow and pH, and we have staff on site at the treatments to monitor, to do continuous monitoring throughout the entire treatment.
Thank you. And just as a reminder, folks, if you have questions, to please type them in the questions box of your GoToMeeting dashboard. Another question, Jill, is were citizen scientists involved in collecting sea lamprey data?
Yes, to an extent. We had a program called the Lamprey Hunters, which relies on primarily anglers to enter information about where and when they found a lamprey, how many, and that is all entered into a database that is then given to the Sea Lamprey Control Program and is incorporated into their different data sets so that when we get to the stage, typically what would happen, I think, is particularly if we had some feedback that sea lamprey were being found in a system that we weren't traditionally aware of, assessment crews would be sent there to do some more formal evaluation of the system and see what they would find. But like I said, all that information is provided to the Sea Lamprey Control Program and is used to guide their decisions.
Great. And this next question I'm going to ask in two parts. So the first is, can you talk about the role that modeling played in sea lamprey control? And as a sub-question to that, do you have models that allow you to predict the total effect on the Great Lakes of treatment or barriers or in specific streams?
The short answer to that is yes. I'm not sure, but I'm not the most qualified person to talk about the more detailed aspects of the modeling program or the way that modeling is incorporated into our program. I'm happy to sort of find out more in terms of specifics about what it is that we're modeling and how it is incorporated into the control program, but I'm not sure I'm the best one to answer that question.
Okay, thank you. So those are all the questions we have for you right now, and I know you might have to leave early, so we'll see when we get to the end if you're still on the line and if we get any more questions for you.
Good. Thank you.
Thanks, Jill. So now I am pleased to introduce our next presenter, Dr. Jim Koopman. Dr. Koopman is a professor emeritus and a researcher in the Department of Epidemiology in the School of Public Health at the University of Michigan. He has undergraduate and medical degrees from University of Michigan, a pediatrics residency from UCLA, and a Master of Public Health from University of Washington. He has worked in national and global public health for 50 years, and he initially worked in public health service positions, including Epidemic Intelligence Service Officer for the CDC, State Epidemiologist for the State of Washington, Epidemiologist for Cali, Colombia, and Director of an Epidemic Intelligence Training Program in Mexico. In 1986, he switched from public health fieldwork to developing theory that serves public health, and his major work now involves mathematical and computer modeling of infectious diseases. He has the policy unit of the Center for Inference and Dynamics of Infectious Diseases, and early on in his career, he worked on smallpox eradication and is currently working on polio eradication with the World Health Organization and the National Institute of Health Support. He was invited to speak in the hope that public health experiences in infection control and eradication might be useful for Great Lakes issues like mussel and other invasive species control. So Dr. Koopman, with that, we will, looks like we have you up as presenter status, and feel free to get started.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for the invitation. There have been a few things learned from disease eradication efforts. But actually, we're learning a lot from ecological control efforts now as well. So it's good to have this interchange. Oops, I can't advance my. Oh, there we go. So I'm going to talk about. I was asked to talk about smallpox eradication, but I'm going to give some antecedents about that for yellow fever and malaria, and then talk about smallpox, and finally. Polio eradication, to which I dedicate almost full time now, and it's at a critical stage. We're in year 28 of a 12-year program, and we're spending every year $1 billion more than the total original program was the cost. So, and then finally, I'll talk about some collaborative modeling to set and achieve goals. This was one of the individuals who first made the got the world moving toward undertaking global eradication efforts. This is Fred Soper. He was the first director of PAHO and the Department of Roland Rockefeller Foundation. So the thing about the yellow fever eradication program is that it really started before they had an understanding that monkeys were carrying could carry the virus and sustain the virus. At first, it was thought that there were just outbreaks in big cities related to Aedes aegypti. Aedes aegypti, the common mosquito that you now all know associated with the Zika virus and dengue virus and chikungunya virus. So after that discovery, they changed the program from the objectives from yellow fever eradication to Aedes aegypti eradication. And the reason for the switch was they were having such great, what at least appeared to be such great success eradicating Aedes aegypti. The organization program was focused was a very rigid program without much exploration of new approaches in scientific investigation of biological or social processes. And the philosophy was almost all the resources had to be put in the field work and checking of the field work. So the organization doesn't sound like it was too tremendously different than what we just heard about for lampreys. So here's from one of Soper's articles in 1961 saying that we're almost there. We've eradicated the Aedes aegypti from so much of the Americas, and we can eradicate from all of the Americas if we can just convince the United States and a few other spots to do that. They never convinced the United States. In the late 1980s, after dengue, just looking now at specifically Cuba, after dengue reinvaded the Americas and the Latin Americas, as you heard, I spent a lot of my career in Latin America, and the Latin Americans always said the failure was strictly because the Americans didn't do the job. And after the epidemics of severe dengue in Cuba, Cuba supposedly once again eradicated dengue and Aedes aegypti. But for those of us who follow ProMed, field workers and people in Cuba let us know that that really wasn't true. So what the world learned from yellow fever, strong theorem, I think is detailed, and I would say dictatorial. Fritz Hooker was a Brazilian, and he was working in the time of the Getulio Vargas dictatorship. And because of that dictatorship, he could use very dictatorial means to knock down health threats. However, the lack of knowledge about transmission routes and dynamics, aids dip the eradication being a fool's errand. Monkey host made yellow fever eradication unpalatable because you'd have to kill monkeys. And mosquito population dynamics allow aids to spring back full force from undetectable levels. And that just wasn't adequately understood. So what the world needed to learn that initial empirical success is a weak base on which to build an eradication program. You got to have enough scientific understanding. And not just about the organisms that you're dealing with, but the overall population dynamics. Eradication programs need a wide community of scientists to work openly on understanding what is involved in successes and failures. And the basic science and technological information should be built into big eradication programs. Programs that should be prepared to shift from eradication to control objectives. Now, this is a big topic. I'll not get into it. But the choice of going into an eradication rather than control requires a huge difference. If it is justified, even if eradication is justified, if programs are built so that the eradication program can serve control objectives, if it's failed, that it should be pursued. So the next lesson is malaria. CDC was founded on malaria success, and that's what got it started as an institution building toward what it is today. From the upper two pictures, you can see the early control efforts were, like drainage, to eliminate breeding sites, and aerial spraying. The two big elements were DDT control and chloroquine control. So in 1955, the World Health Organization began Global Malaria Eradication Campaign. And they really built off the SOPA approach and the SOPA philosophy to Aedes aegypti control, still feeling that that had been successful at that time. The success in developed countries and in India, but by 1969, there was resistance to DDT and chloroquine being the treatment. And so they just gave up. The reasons for the failure were never completely understood. There was quite an inadequate understanding of the biology and inadequate efforts to understand the transmission dynamics. So just a further comment about the one of the big areas of misunderstanding, because there's now a new big a program to eradicate malaria, and the parasite has many different steps. And one of the key ones is that there are sexual gametocytes that have to mate within the host, and then they have to mate within the mosquito. They have to be uptaken from the human host, and we really don't know very much at all about what stimulates the persistence and level of these gametocytes. And as a consequence, we don't know how much of the problem is being caused by that. If you look evolutionarily, the perturbation of those gametocytes and their ability to spring up at times when people are perfectly well, is important for the overall control effort. So when Melinda Gates came out and said we're going to eradicate malaria again, and most of us in the field said, "Oh, who failed to get to her to talk to her about this?" You know, it's not quite a logical thing. They have made some successes with insecticide impregnated bed nets. They're looking for key technical innovations, and they're making some progress there. But the vaccine pace is extremely fast waning of immunity, so the vaccine doesn't look like it's going to work. Bill Gates himself established a company called the Institute for Disease Modeling computer modeling, mathematical modeling of the malaria eradication and other eradication efforts. Bill Gates spent the one day a month in this company doing the modeling. But there's still not enough basic science to understand how the problems will arise when the program changes. So then smallpox was then started relatively soon after malaria failed. And WHO was so embarrassed by the malaria failure that when they thought that they had a potential winner in smallpox, they really pursued it. The administrative structure was derived in this history from yellow fever and malaria. And the WHO maps for malaria served the smallpox. D.A. Henderson, who just died recently, was a lot in the news, focused all the efforts. He was the leader assigned WHO. Focused all efforts outside of WHO, which is absolutely necessary to strip the WHO bureaucracy. I've been involved with the WHO bureaucracy for quite many years, and I knew the need to do that. One of the key things is that DA and the other leadership were quite flexible to changing directions. And they had a very grand success because it was an easy target. And the other message I'm not going to talk about these individually, that rudimentary modeling was enough to guide their decisions, but they were morally questionable decisions leading to success. So regarding the flexible leadership, they believed that infection was highly contagious, that vaccine immunity was short-lived, and high coverage was needed to reach the transmission threshold. Bill Fagan, working on the program in Africa, found that, when they vaccinated 150% of the population, they still didn't get control. And the reason was they kept vaccinating the same people over and over again. And missing the same people. Transmission was very slow. Not at all. Everybody thinks of, it's very contagious. It's very virulent, but it's not very contagious. And so spread is quite slow. The program initially based was on mass vaccination, but then at one time they ran out of the vaccine in Africa, and they tried to figure out the way to use the least amount of vaccine. In the resulting analysis, they settled on this in the square at the bottom, the ring vaccination concept. You have a case, you look at the set of contacts around the case, and then the set of contacts to contact. And that ring vaccination strategy proved to be very highly effective because, for various reasons, smallpox is an easy target given this. Usually just looking at a face is enough to diagnose a case of smallpox. On the upper right hand, you see a worker carrying the exact same image that I carried around with me all the time when I was working in India on smallpox eradication, where I saw the last 12 smallpox cases in Azamgarh district of India. You could get a lot of people to bring other people that might have been potentially have some of those symptoms, and then it's easy enough to make the diagnosis. But the other key to success is that vaccination after exposure to a case can prevent an infection and subsequent transmission. Vaccinations easily, the localized vaccine was stable. And so you had 2 weeks to find exposed individuals to present them, and longer if you're taking the second breath. The other thing that made this program highly successful is this reward system. The most dangerous thing I did in India was going to Lucknow to get the huge amount of money that I had to bring back from Lucknow to Azamgarh district in order to hand out the rewards. Because of all the carry got a lot of money in a place where there are a lot of thieves. That was the only dangerous thing that I really did. It's just not only rudimentary model being needed. At the time, most mathematicians were doing the modeling, but there were people at WHO doing modeling, but the leadership of the program sort of disparaged the modeling. Bill Sagi did a thought experiment after his experience about not having much vaccine, and so he's, it was before and after this experience, he just worked out, a sort of mental model that, my God, this could work. It was sort of back-of-the-envelope kind of model. This thing, I put Bill Sagi's picture up there. He was really an inspiring leader. I mean, he's the only person in my entire life that I say, if he called me to do anything, I would do it. About the vaccine. They used the Russian vaccine because it had a higher take rate, and it seemed to induce more immunity. But its higher take rate and more immunity was also associated with very severe progressive local vaccinia. And I mean, I had the experience that working in this, backward area, there wasn't a single pane of glass in the entire 4 million population of Azangar district during the time that I worked there. And I had the experience of one of the children that I vaccinated having progressive vaccinia and losing their arm and losing their life after they lost their arm. So, you don't hear much about that, but that's some of the kind of things that were involved. Well, now building on the success, the next big eradication is polio. The program began in 1988. At that time, very high number of cases. And the goal was set for eradication by 2000. Tremendous efforts in the field. It really is the greatest global communitarian effort ever undertaken, and it's a beautiful thing that has to come to success, and we're working very hard to make it to come to success and to understand why it hasn't been to success. So we're in year 28 of a 12-year program, and consuming every year more than the original 12-year program cost. What was the cost? Success is needed now so we can pursue easier targets. I mean, measles, we all agree, would be an easier target, but we can't start that until polio is ended. The biggest problems I see are there's been a lack of understanding of transmission dynamics. The program data is constrained to 3 modeling groups because of the agreement that the director of WHO, Margaret Chan, had to make with all of the 197 countries. When you have 197 countries making an agreement to set a rule, it makes everything pretty rigid. And ultimately, then the theorists who could best use the data don't get the data. And the other thing of it is, unlike the smallpox eradication, where everybody would talk and develop theories about how it was spreading, where it was spreading, what was involved, and people would generate hypotheses, and we'd go out and maybe the local people generating hypotheses. Because local people know more about people's movement and more about the local area. In polio eradication, we haven't had that same degree of local input about the spread. And part of that is that the spread isn't quite so obvious most of the time. Of course, the Taliban and the Boko Haram are blamed for the failure. And it's true that the Taliban in Pakistan and Afghanistan have really made, they've killed lots of vaccinators and made vaccination quite difficult. And the same goes for Boko Haram in Nigeria. But if we'd understood things better, we could have avoided the problems generated by those. So. Thinking about the program or organization, as I said, it was inherited from the Yellow Fever, malaria, smallpox. there is more research in this area, mainly implementation operations research and vaccine research. There is modeling of transmission dynamics, but there's not much science going into the transmission dynamics modeling. I'm trying to change that. The program, a wise decision was to make it not just WHO, but it started off with WHO, UNICEF, our United States Centers for Disease Control, and Rotary International. They formed the Global Polio Eradication Initiative. And that structure allowed, avoiding a lot of the bureaucracy from WHO. The program got a big input from the Gates Foundation quite a bit of time after the original goal date of 2000. So they helped establish new diagnostic monitoring, mapping, and modeling tools, allowing faster and more accurate tracking of polio cases transmission patterns. But the basic science of transmission dynamics, to my mind, has just not been adequately pursued. So we have a polio endgame eradication problem now. High transmission countries that quickly reached high vaccination levels eradicated quickly. A big example there is Bangladesh. Bangladesh didn't get started on eradication until about 2005. But they ramped up from practically zero to very high levels of vaccination, not very high levels, modestly high levels of vaccination, within 2 years, where they covered everybody. And all transmission in Bangladesh stopped. And the reason that quick ramp up made such a big difference is that it gave no time for the immunity that people had acquired from the circulation of the wild polio virus. So that naturally acquired immunity was still there to help the vaccination induced immunity be enough to stop transmission. Those who took a long time in programs like in India let immunity wane in older age groups. And then the older age groups helped maintain the transmission. But the vaccination stayed focused on the children because the WHO was afraid to change their story about what it was that was going to be eradication. So the overall strategy that has been used in the last 15 years is if you see a problem detected by acute flaccid paralysis surveillance, acute flaccid paralysis, floppy arms and floppy legs in kids. And if you make sure everyone with those symptoms gets cultured for polio, then you can detect polio. And the strategy was, you know, wherever you get those detections, you then hit that area hard and knock it down. It's a whack-a-mole strategy. The whack-a-mole strategy isn't working very well right now because we have silent circulation, but I'm not going to go into that too much. Just to end here, are there any general messages? I don't understand exactly the structure that's going into invasive muscle control, but if you get monitors, program people, and outside groups working together so that they're continually mapping what we do and do not know while they are mapping muscle, that, I think, is a very key issue. Get a broad community of scientists, a broad community of interested people, developing hypotheses, reacting to data that the programs gather. Use collaborative modeling software. There's a great movement around the world now of getting citizen modelers, and there's nice software being developed to get citizen modelers involved. As an epidemiologist, I've always said the first task is to talk to the local people who know the population and who can develop the appropriate hypothesis. And modeling, it works in the same way. You've got to get people to understand the essential elements that you have to model. And then involving citizen scientists not only in gathering data, but in conceptualizing spread and control. And finally, avoid the kind of problems that polio has had, and make all data open so that smart people are attracted to analyze. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Just in the interest of time, I am going to hold questions till after our third presenter at this point, but encourage people to continue inputting their questions in the questions pane, and we will start to address those following our third presenter. So our third and final presenter today is David Stiver, and he is the Forestry Services Manager for the City of Milwaukee, Wisconsin. He is responsible for directing a highly progressive municipal forestry program encompassing natural resource conservation, these program maintenance, and reforestation components. He administers a $17 million budget and a staff of 180 full-time employees that maintain a street tree population of 194,000 trees, 120 miles of irrigated landscape boulevards, and a 160-acre municipal nursery that produces 4,000 trees and 300,000 annuals and perennials each year. Prior to joining Milwaukee, David served as the city forester for the city of Norfolk, Virginia, city arborist for the city of Virginia Beach, Virginia, and urban forester for the Virginia Department of Forestry and Texas Forest Service. He holds a Bachelor of Science degree in Forestry and Natural Resources from the University of Michigan and Kent State University, respectively, and a Master of Science degree in Horticulture from Virginia Tech. He is an ISA-certified arborist, an ISA-qualified tree risk assessor, and is the current chair of the Wisconsin Urban Forestry Council. So, David, it looks like you have your presentation up, so take it away.
Thank you, Erica. Good afternoon, everybody. It's a pleasure to be with you. It's an interesting discussion here of a wide variety of topics, and so let me introduce a third one for you. What I'd like to share with you today is Milwaukee's strategy to utilize a very innovative technology and strategy for managing emerald ash borer. And we'll get into that as to what that is here shortly in the presentation, but I realize that in a group this diverse that perhaps some of you are not aware what emerald ash borer is. It is a major invasive forest pest that is largely affecting ash trees throughout the Midwest and northeastern states and rapidly spreading across the country. It is a pest that was introduced from China. Complete metamorphosis, and so the adults lay the eggs in the bark of ash trees. The eggs hatch and develop into larvae that feed on the inner bark or the phloem of the tree, which then disrupts the flow of nutrients and water in the tree, and ultimately can kill a large tree in a short period of time of 3 to 4 years following initial infestation. Emerald ash borer was first detected in the United States in the Detroit area in 2002. It is believed that the insect was probably in that region for as many as 8 to 10 years before it was found. It just took that long for the population to build up to begin killing trees. And since that time, it has now spread to 25 states, killing tens, if not hundreds of millions of ash trees in two Canadian provinces. Emerald ash borer was confirmed in Milwaukee in 2012, and you can see on the screen here some private trees where we found the infestation. This happened to be about a 4 to 5 year old infestation when we found it, which is pretty typical for this pest. It's very difficult to detect at low population levels, and it's often when you see advanced symptoms of decline that it's first found. And what made this a very interesting first spine for the city was that it was directly adjacent to a block of ash street trees that we had treated two times previously with triage, a systemic insecticide, and those trees were perfectly healthy, and so our mayor at our press conference at this location could point to the success of our program and also point to the outcome of non-treatment. And so here it is now, you know, 7 years later, and or at least 7 years since it was found in Wisconsin. And we are seeing tree mortality in our city now in many of our neighborhoods. So prior to emerald ash borer being found in our city or even detected in our state, we, of course, did our due diligence to reach out to other states, other agencies that have been battling with emerald ash borer to determine what we can learn. And from that, we formulated a strategy for battling this pest. And that strategy was based on two factors. One was a risk assessment. We felt we needed to fully understand what was at risk in our community. And also, we felt that if we could understand what was at risk, we could then begin to answer questions about how to best manage that risk. So in terms of risk assessment, obviously there's a vast population of trees that represents the host for this pest. However, in Milwaukee, we didn't know how many trees in our city were at risk, so we didn't know how big of a problem it was. And we also recognized that these ash trees were providing ecological service benefits in terms of energy savings or stormwater reduction benefits or air quality improvement benefits that represented a risk to us as well. We certainly understood that large dead and dying shade trees represent a risk to public safety, both in terms of public trees that may be infested as well as private trees. And certainly we understood from others that when you get this type of pest in your city, it's going to require significant resource reallocation and have a fiscal impact in your city's budget. So in terms of risk management, we understood that certainly our public safety was the largest risk management factor we had to manage, as both person and property were at risk to our city from dead and dying ash trees. And as a professional organization managing the street tree population in the city, we felt a duty to help our community prepare as much as possible for emerald ash borer as well. And one of the lessons we learned, and this is not unique to emerald ash borer, but is pretty germane to the most invasive pests and diseases and organisms that land in the United States, is that the role of the state and federal agencies is largely population monitoring. And while it's important to understand, I think, where emerald ash borer is, and through research there have been some trapping protocols have been developed, and they're really not very good even to this date. But nonetheless, that was what the focus of the state and federal agencies are, was to monitor the population. And so they developed this trapping program, and people began asking the question, what is this purple thing hanging in the tree? So a campaign developed around the trapping for emerald ash borer to answer that, and it was an opportunity to educate the public on what the purple thing was in the tree and why it was there and what it was attempting to do, and that was to catch adult beetles. And really, I think the question that both the federal and state agencies were asking with this program is, where is emerald ash borer? And I think it's important to, when you're faced with a major forest pest or any invasive organism, to make sure you ask the right questions. And for us, we understood that if we couldn't find out where the ash trees were that were at risk to emerald ash borer in our community, the outcome that we would have would be no different than what Michigan and Indiana and Illinois ahead of us with the loss of tens of millions of ash trees. And so we were interested in asking the question, where are the ash in our community? And we used hyperspectral imaging and remote sense technology to be able to answer that question. So in terms of risk assessment, we had pretty much a three-prong strategy. And so we fortunately at this time had a computerized street tree inventory that gave us information about the structure and function of the ash trees in our city that were on our streets and under our control. Many cities have similar computerized street tree inventories. And in our inventory, we have 194,000 street trees that we manage. 33,000 of those are ash trees at risk to emerald ash borer, representing about 17% of our canopy that's at risk. And we also understood that this ash resource represented about a $46 million asset. And if we were to do nothing more than simply remove the trees either in advance of emerald ash borer or as trees became infested. That removal and replacement cost with just a 3-inch caliper tree represented a large dollar investment of $27 million. So I think the point here is understanding what the risk is and being able to communicate that in terms of dollars. It was very helpful to us in being able to garner resources to be able to manage this pest. We knew very little at this time about the overall canopy or tree canopy, urban tree canopy in our city. And so we conducted in 2008 an iTree U4 Ecosystem Services benefit analysis, which was based on systematic plots distributed throughout our city to help us understand what the structure and the composition of the urban tree canopy is in the city and the benefits that those trees provide. And from that study, we found out that we have 3.3 million trees in the city, covering about 22% of our land area. And really the purpose for doing this study at that time was to understand how big of a problem emerald ash borer would be to our city. And from this, we discovered that 577,000 ash trees were in our city, representing 17.4% of our tree canopy. This study also allowed us to calculate the asset value or the structural value of the entire tree canopy in our city, and also the annual functional values of ecosystem services benefits that were provided from this forest resource. And again, the numbers are going to be different from city to city, but the point is understanding what's at risk in terms of a dollar value that you can then leverage for resources to help implement a management strategy is incredibly important. And then we also, from that data, we estimated what the impact would be with the loss of ash canopy in our city. And we estimated that would be about a $210 million loss in value or asset value and somewhere around $4 million in annual functional benefit loss with the removal of ash in our community. The third prong of our assessment strategy was we, as I indicated, we wanted to know where the ash trees were at risk to emerald ash borer. Emerald ash borer is very good at finding ash trees. And so we recognized that if we were going to have any different outcome than other states and other cities ahead of us that had it prior to us, that we needed to find out where the ash trees were before the beetle found them. And so we used a technology called hyperspectral imaging. And while our U4 or iTree Eco study was important in terms of quantifying the number of ash trees at risk in our community, which helped us to begin to answer questions about how is this going to impact our staffing and budgeting needs, and what will this mean in terms of the wood waste volume we're likely to see entering our waste stream, and what opportunities did that provide for us in terms of repurposing that wood. But I think most importantly, it allowed us to a technology to be able to map the location of trees at risk so that we could do something proactive with that information. And this was the first of its kind project using this emergent technology. It has been since replicated in a few cities in the states as well as in Canada, and has become a representative best practice for managing invasive forest pests. Because the technology was so new, at least in terms of vegetation mapping, we literally had to pull together a team of international experts to be able to complete this project. We also had some local partners that joined with us to help defray the cost and realize some information gained from this project as well. So in 2008, we put an aircraft in the air with a hyperspectral sensor in it, and we flew the city and imaged the city with the intent of targeting ash trees in our city. We also collected LIDAR data, which is light detection and ranging data, which is often used for precise survey work. And this helped us to improve the positional accuracy and output of the trees, ash trees at risk in our city. There are two really kind of major attributes that influence the success or failure of a hyperspectral imaging project. One is the spatial resolution, and that's the minimum resolving distance between adjacent features or the minimum size of an object that can be detected. So we were interested in mapping ash trees and to a minimum crown diameter of about 15 feet or a meter or so. And you can think of this spatial resolution as a camera resolution. The larger the pixel, the more information you're going to have in that pixel, the less you're going to be able to pull details out of that pixel. So it's important to find the right balance between pixel or spatial resolution size and in terms of the information you want to extract. You don't want your pixels to be so small that your data set becomes unmanageable. The other important attribute is spectral resolution. And spectral resolution it relates to the precision of hyperspectral sensors. And so that's typically measured in spectral resolution, which is the width of each band of the spectrum that is captured. Unlike multispectral imagery, which maps in the visible part of the light spectrum, the red, blue, and green bands, as well as the entire infrared band as one band, and that's often called four-band mapping, that would allow you to distinguish between vegetation and other objects on the Earth's surface, but does not allow you to distinguish within that vegetation band individual species. So to do that, we had to use hyperspectral imagery, which is a much more precise imagery technology. And hyperspectral imagery is often referred to as narrowband mapping, and it allows the user to define the hyperspectral sensor precision or the width of each band that data is captured throughout the entire infrared spectrum. And narrowband segments, we used a 10 nanometer narrowband width. And what that means is we were looking across this entire electromagnetic spectrum from 700 to 2400 nanometers in 10 nanometer widths, looking for where ash trees reflected and were picked up by the sensor. So as sunlight hits the Earth's surface, our eye detects what is being reflected off that image, both in color and shape and so forth. And so do the sensors. And so the sensors picking up on the reflection, the energy reflected in a nanometer scale that's being reflected off the objects in the Earth's surface. And we were targeting, of course, ash leaves. And the thinking is with this technology that if you can identify along this infrared band where your object is reflecting, you can pull that out or parse that out of your data set and then map it and eliminate all the other noise and data that's in that image set and only map what your target feature is. And so while we had this aircraft in the air, we also put lift trucks in the air to be able to measure what we call the spectral signature. So this is the reflectance signature coming off the top of at the canopy top where the aerial spectrometer was mounted and would be measuring from. We also measured with a hand spectrometer to capture the spectral signature of ash trees and also other common trees in our city to be able to distinguish between ash and other species. And this graph simply shows ash as compared to other types of trees we captured spectral signatures from. And while there's a lot of detail in this graph, I mainly show it just to so you can see that each of these species has a unique signature that can be distinguished one from another. And even if we wanted to map green and white ash separately, we could do that. They reflect differently. This is an image of the LIDAR data we collected and provides very precise location information. We wanted to use this information to perform outreach to property owners that had ash trees. So we wanted to know exactly where that tree set with respect to a parcel or a property within the city limits. This image shows some early returns of the hyperspectral data. And you can see on the left there, just a black and white extraction of the imagery, hyperspectral imagery, and then a color exploitation of that. And what's evident here is that the sensor was picking up unique species that were reflecting the same along that spectrometer, the electromagnetic spectrum, and we were seeing patterns develop. And in Milwaukee and many cities, our species are diversified, at least in the past have been diversified, on a block level or a street level. So we're seeing patterns indicating unique species and three different species here, and showing some patterns. So we gave the our vendor our street tree inventory data, which is reflected by the blue dots here. The blue dots are ash street trees. Hyperspectral imagery and multispectral imagery maps in the infrared part of their light range, and so chlorophyll in that part of the spectrum reflects red. So anything that's green in vegetation reflects red in hyperspectral imagery. That's why the canopy of these trees reflect red. I think what's interesting to note here, just as a side note, if you lived in a community that had watering restrictions and you wanted to find out who's watering, you could look at turf, for instance, where my pointer is pointed here, and see some pretty red turf. That's reflective of a high chlorophyll and a high healthy turf versus this turf on this property here, which is brown and not being watered. So you could use this technology to catch people if you wanted to that were violating an irrigation restrictive policy. But I think what was exciting then when we started getting some data back is that the green pixels here are what the imagery was capturing and identifying as ash trees. And so you can see that the close correlation of the blue are confirmed ash street trees and what the imagery was picking up as ash. And for the first time, we were starting to get information about ash trees on private property, for which we had no information previously, that we could then begin to help our community get ready for M-O-4 as well. This is what the imagery looks like to us as it was delivered to us as an ESRI file, a shape file. And so it's a pixelated image, but then when we overlay this on a parcel map, we do a very good data on where ash trees are in our community. It's important to note, I think particularly for this group, that one of the species at risk, green ash, is a common floodplain species. And so this is showing part of our Milwaukee River. We have three rivers that run through our city. All of them have a significantly high percentage of ash canopy. And as Emerald Ash Borer sweeps through our city and takes out the ash, there's going to be water quantity impacts as a result of the loss of this canopy. There's going to be invasive species impacts as buckthorn and other species grow and occupy these voids left from the ash, dying ash canopy. And we suspect there'll be water quality issues as well as sedimentation and so forth that was protected by this canopy is gone. So once we got the spectral imagery delivered, the data set delivered as a parcel map, that map indicated that we had ash canopy on about 42,000 parcels citywide. And we wanted to identify where the tree was specifically on the property and specifically with respect to ownership of that property. And so those 42,000 parcels, when you think about where a tree may sit on a property, that canopy often extends over property lines. So in many cases, we had canopy that was extending over two or sometimes three properties that resided and was owned by one property owner. So we put interns out, Urban Forestry College interns out for two summers, and they were visiting 41,847 properties to confirm the location of ash trees, ownership, and to confirm that it was an ash tree. And from that effort, we confirmed over 15,000 households that had one or more ash trees, and we made direct contact with those property owners, either verbally with a discussion on the property or leaving materials behind if they weren't home. And we found through that effort that the vast majority of our community was not paying attention to Emerald Ash Borer messaging because they didn't know they had an ash tree. And so we helped them understand that they had an ash tree and that they had an ash tree that was at risk to a major forest pest. The percent ash that were confirmed on private property was 49%, meaning that the imagery had a lot of false positives. And that's inherent in this technology currently. And as more projects are done mapping vegetation, the accuracy will improve. And so while the hyperspectral imagery, at least with the way the metrics we had set up on our project, resulted in 51% false positives that had to be parsed out of our data through ground truthing. We found that indeed 99% of the ash trees in our city were mapped accurately. So it was really good at mapping our target, but it mapped beyond our target because the differences in the reflectance of say a honey locust or a Norway maple or a silver maple are really all not that different from an ash tree, and it's very difficult to distinguish that. And then also, while the crews were out, we asked them to look for ash trees that maybe the sensor didn't pick up, and these might have been ash trees that were under the canopy of other trees or small trees. And citywide, they only found 69 additional ash trees. So we felt really good about the accuracy of our ash mapping. So in summary, in terms of what the verification was in the field, hyperspectral imaging was very accurate at mapping ash, our target species. False positives were problematic, and we found that silver maple and honey locust, two species, accounted for 71% of the false positives among the six most common false positive species. And because these are very different in appearance and leaf shape, we felt it was a reasonable error that we could account for and easily correct for through field verification. We use this information to create a parcel map that is accessible to our public on our website. And I have a live link here. I'm not going to take the time to go to it now, but if I were to, you could type in your address and go to your address, and it would highlight whether you had a green parcel, which indicates we found an ash at that property, or a white parcel where there was no ash. And as we find emerald ash borer, we're also including information on the parcel as to what the find was and what the action was where that tree was found, and typically that's a removal action that's required. But you can see in this image here, this is just one clip out of the city, that a lot of the parcels, a large percentage of the parcels in our city have ash trees. I'm often asked, what does it cost? And people think that it's cost prohibitive. Well, we spent about $164,000 to image 94 square miles of area in our city. So about $1,750 per square mile was our cost to both collect and analyze the data for hyperspectral imaging. And then we spent another $135,000 over two summers to pay intern wages with vehicles and supply costs to field verify the data and do outreach to the property owners. So our total cost was about $277,000 for this project. When you consider that we're spending $1 million a year just to treat 14,000 ash street trees every year to protect them from emerald ash borer, this is a drop in the bucket. This is an expensive pest to manage. And we've also been able to use this project to leverage several grants, and we've been able to pull in about $600,000 in grant money to date as a result of having used a very emergent technology successfully to help our community get prepared for emerald ash borer. We also spent a lot of time and effort continuing to provide awareness to our community to help them understand the importance of being proactive with this pest. And here you can see we kicked off our ash street tree injection program in 2009 with our mayor, as Mayor Tom Barrett, injecting our very first tree. And, of course, all the media were there. It was a great media event as well as a public relations awareness event. We are injecting, as I mentioned, about 14,000 ash street trees a year. This does provide about 2 years of protection, although there's some research that's showing that we could probably get 3 years of protection with a little higher chemical rate. The chemical delivery system is very safe. It doesn't all the materials contained in the tree. It's very precise, and the amount that's delivered has slowed the spread benefits in terms of emerald ash borer spreading in our city, because any emerald ash borer that lands on a treated tree is then killed. Our cost is about $70. For a 2-year rate for an 18-inch diameter tree, so it's cost effective. We're budgeting currently about $1 million a year to treat about 14,500 trees. I think the perhaps some of the greatest value of this treatment program is that it allows us to manage risk during whatever transition period we may choose to transition this ash population to resistant species over time. and it puts that removal schedule on our calendar, not Emerald Ashmore's calendar. It allows us to, while we had to add this program and add staff to complete this work, we still are able to prune trees, still able to plant trees and remove other hazardous trees in the city. All the other programs and services we deliver, we continue to still do that. And it also prevented a catastrophic loss of street tree canopy and the associated benefits of that. In conjunction with our treatment program, there is about 5,000 of our street tree population, ash population, that is not treated. And as those trees become infested, we are taking those out. This program has allowed us to launch a very effective urban wood utilization program. And with those logs are being processed for value-added products. And I don't have time to share that, but it's been an exciting outcome of this effort. It was kind of the silver lining of EAB for us. And it's also caused us to think how we diversify our population, and we are now diversifying intra-block, multiple species in general within a block, rather than by block or street diversification. So with that, I'll be happy to take any questions we may have time for, and there's my contact information.
Thank you. And so we do have a couple of questions, both for you, David, and also for Jim. So I'm going to go ahead and open the lines here. So our first question for David, are there any genetic markers or gene-based techniques to detect infected trees?
Not that I'm aware of currently.
Okay. And this question is for Jim, actually, but maybe the other speakers might have some perspectives to offer on this as well. Early in one of your slides, you mentioned making a decision between the goals being either control or eradication. So could you talk a little bit more about the decision-making in the disease eradication field between control and eradication and criteria or decision-making processes?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. Our initial strategy was driven by risk, and we recognized that with a population of 33,000 ash street trees, knowing how quickly this pest can sweep through a city, we knew that we could quickly become overwhelmed with dead and dying ash trees that we couldn't get to with our existing resources. So we began treating largely as to put us in control over what the outcome of those trees may be over time. And what we found is that it was so cost effective to treat versus remove and replacement that we couldn't get any support for preemptive removal and replacement, but yet we can get continued funding to treat. And another presentation which might be of interest for a future webinar would be that we followed up, and just last year completed a study, and I've been speaking around the country on this. We looked at our experience with Dutch elm disease, where the city lost 105,000 elm street trees to Dutch elm disease. And we measured that canopy loss and the benefit loss associated with that over a 60-year period. And we calculated the lost or foregone benefits associated with Dutch elm disease and considered the management costs related to managing Dutch elm disease at a very aggressive rate, as well as prospectively looking at Emerald Ashmore 20 years out. And what we found from that study is that, indeed, it's in terms of the return on your investment, you get three times the return on your investment when you're treating ash trees to preserve the benefits that those trees provide than you would if you followed a preemptive removal and replacement strategy that many cities are following. So that helped confirm that we made the right decision, and I think is another best management practice for future cities as they are confronted with forest pests as to how to best determine what is the right strategy for that community.
Thank you.
I'll respond to that question. Like the smallpox and polio, which are major targets now for eradication, and originally the thought with yellow fever and malaria as well, there's a huge difference in total cost over time of you know, intensive level of control that has to be ongoing for a very long time versus completely getting rid of something and then being able to stop control efforts. Of course, then the potential that people thought of using smallpox as a bioterrorist thing sort of affected that calculation somewhat. But so that people are not as willing to stop all control activities. But with smallpox, we have stopped all control activities, and it's been a great saving. But the comment I made is that if you set an eradication objective, that doesn't really necessarily use the same methodology or can't go back and use some of that methodology within a control activity, which is what's happening with our polio eradication program. And that you don't have the option of going back to control. So previously, you know, we didn't have the kind of modeling power that we could consider those decisions and make sure that our strategies were, you know, could be transferable between those different decisions. But nowadays, we do.
Thanks. And Jill, if you're still on the line, or I believe we have Mark Gaydon from the Fishery Commission, can you speak to that at all in terms of sea lamprey?
This is Mark. I'm not sure if Jill is still on, but I'll answer that. The eradication of the sea lamprey is, at the minimum, not seen as cost-effective. Chasing that last pair of mating lampreys starts getting cost-prohibitive, we probably don't have enough lampricide in the world to do that. There's just an awful lot of good sea lamprey spawning habitat. And then there's a philosophical question, too, about whether it is even possible to eradicate a species that's reproducing in such large numbers as lamprey in a system as large as the Great Lakes. But suffice it to say that given the resources that we have and the success of the control program, it's unlikely that we would be on a course for eradication.
Thank you. And this question is for David again. Could a more detailed Google Earth replace hyperspectral imaging?
Well, if they were using a spectrometer, a hyperspectral spectrometer, then they would have the raw data, but the raw data has to be analyzed. And just to give you a sense for how large of a data set is created when you're doing imagery like this, our 94 square miles was just about a terabyte of data, and which had to be parsed out for just the ash. So it became a much more manageable size when we were only looking at the ash bands that were reflecting. But on a Google scale, where they're mapping the entire Earth's surface, it'd be a huge database, and then there'd be all the analysis that would be required to extract any target out of that data. So the sensors are picking up everything. They're mapping everything on the Earth's surface. You've got to do analysis with algorithms to be able to extract out your target signatures.
Thanks. And David, another question for you. Could you talk a little bit at all about how you estimated the value of the different
ecosystem service benefits?
Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Well, that was done through a software application called iTree Eco. That's a application. It's a freeware that's available that was developed by the U.S. Forest Service with some university and corporate collaborative partners, and it's actually quite good. There you can go to itreetools.org, and you can find iTree Eco as well as the other tools that are in that suite for assessing urban tree canopy.
Thank you. And Jim, a question for you. Can you speak at all about the collaboration amongst scientists and researchers that occurred during any of the programs you spoke about and the mechanisms for that collaboration and either how it was encouraged or maybe discouraged unintentionally?
Well, the one I'm concerned about most at the moment is polio. And I made the point that the data restriction, as an epidemiologist, one of the important things that the epidemiologist should do is to make summaries of surveillance data that let everybody know what's going on. And everybody should be able to use those summaries of surveillance data in ways that help understand the total picture that's happening. And that has not happened in the polio program because of the agreement that Margaret Chan made with the 197 member states. So that's something to be avoided as much as possible. But in terms of doing, you know, collaborative modeling, I really have been impressed with different ecologists doing sort of ecosystems modeling with people who have conflicting interests about what ought to happen to a river basin or something like that. And getting everyone together that has competing interests and getting them all to work together, you know, in a scientific a way to create a model of what's happening so people begin to expand their understanding of what's happening. And once they get that understanding, then enough communication starts taking place so that there are ways that people can find compromise. So far that hasn't taken off in epidemiology very much yet, but I'm quite encouraged to see how it's working with in different ecology areas, and I'm working to try to get that established more in epidemiology. As an epidemiologist, when I go, you know, I've gone out investigating hundreds of outbreaks and epidemics, and the key step is to get a lot of people involved because the local people have a lot better ideas than you do about what might be happening in the community that it's affecting. So I have been quite encouraged by the development of new software that enables this kind of modeling that facilitates this kind of modeling. Much of this kind of modeling often begins with people spreading, big white sheets out and drawing on them and mapping out things as a group. But if you have software that starts to use that better, that they can be translated directly into a computer model. A computer model that can have a level of interaction so that people on their cell phones can run that computer model and everybody can interact with it in different ways. I think it's a very promising development that's going to help for a lot of things, maybe even for, you know, invasive muscle control.
Thanks. So we are past our scheduled time for this webinar, but I want to thank all of our speakers and just ask if you have any other closing thoughts you wanted to provide before we wrap up today.
None from me. It was a good webinar.
Thank you again. We really appreciate your time today. We're completing the webinar now, and we thank all of our speakers and our participants. And as a reminder, the recording of the webinar will be posted on the website within the next couple of days. And if you have any additional follow-up questions or comments or ideas that you want to provide for future webinars, please feel free to contact us. Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you.